Sometimes.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Good morning. My name is Blake Curd. I'm the senator from District 12 in Sioux Falls. I have the pleasure of serving as the South Dakota Senate Majority Leader. We've got 1 week to go in the legislative session, and I look forward to your questions this morning. It's a real pleasure to be here with my good friends, Senator Billy Sutton and Senator Troy Heinert.
Welcome, State Senator Ryan Maher, District 28, which encompasses all of northwestern South Dakota. As the senator said last week, but we've also entered into the budget negotiations, starting to talk about the financial picture of the state, looking at different options of where to spend some money and put some money and trying to shore up different programs and make sure that we can leave the state in a good financial position before we leave.
Billy Sutton, District 21 Senator and the Senate Minority Leader. Pleasure to be here. I would say that this type of thing doesn't happen very often, to have both the minority leaders and the majority leaders in the same press conference, but it's kind of fun to shake things up a little bit. And I think I speak for Troy and myself in that we consider these guys friends. And just want to focus on how we get things done by working across the aisle. And even though we might disagree, we don't have to be disagreeable. And at the end of the day, we still walk away as friends. You know, 1 week left. We have a lot of things to determine yet in the budget. As far as this week goes, we were happy to see the state veterans cemetery bill move through the Senate. And much needed, and had a good discussion on it. And so I'm glad we were able to get that done. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Senator Heinert.
Well, good morning, Senator Troy Heinert, District 26 from Mission. I'm excited to see where this next half hour goes, sitting with our good friends on the other side of the aisle. So I'm ready for your questions. Thank you.
Can you all talk about where the Marcy's Law Amendment is going, whether right now it's going on the June primary ballot, what the other bill number might be, if that's a requirement, and kind of your ideas about the concept?
Well, I don't think we know where it's going to land quite yet as we sit here in front of you today. As you know, there was an amendment to HJR 1004 yesterday, and then the resolution did pass. I have not seen a companion bill draft for it yet. I assume that'll arrive shortly. I think that's being handled and negotiated mostly by the House. So my supposition is that they might act on it or send it our direction, then we can have an opportunity to weigh in on it. But that will have some elements in it that make a June ballot possible. And we'll have to wait and see if it negotiates the Senate successfully or not. In order to do that and meet some of the criteria for attorney general explanation and so on, it's going to take two-thirds of the senators to have that transpire. And I can't tell you as we sit here whether that's a likelihood or not.
I think from our perspective, and it seemed like there was pretty broad consensus that it needed to go on the ballot. I mean, it was a compromise from both sides of the issue that came together, and we're trying to find a solution to something in our Constitution that has proven to be a little bit problematic, especially for our counties. And so I think there was broad agreement that we needed to do something. I think from our side, we just simply disagreed with putting it on the primary versus the general. And because we felt that that's going to lead to a smaller percentage of people effectively changing the Constitution, just because fact remains that primary turnout is very much lower than general election. So that's kind of where we were at on it. Look forward to see what the following legislation looks like and what that cost is going to be as it relates to the primary.
Maybe as a follow-up for Democrats, are you concerned about the ideas of this specific amendment being put on the June ballot, or sort of creating a precedent of a potentially more controversial idea putting on later?
No, I mean, I think we're more concerned about the precedent. I mean, I think it was mentioned this has maybe happened one other time relating to the cement plant sale, potentially. But I think this is... I just don't think we want to continue to go down this road of putting it on the primary when we clearly know that in the general you're going to have a better turnout and more people are going to weigh in on that. And so from our perspective, it's not the idea itself, because I think, like I said, we all, at least for the broad group of us, feel that this change is worthwhile to put on the ballot. I think the difference is where it is in the process.
I think for me, in Western South Dakota, you know, without having a primary, without having primary challengers, you know, that doesn't get people to leave the ranch and come to town to vote, you know, just on this bill. Whereas in a general election, you know, they're going to be voting for their candidate, and that gets them to town and vote. So I just think it's a bad idea. The cement plant was a special election, wasn't in the primary. So I think it's a bad idea, and it really limits the ability for a majority of the electorate to be involved in this process.
Well, we're working on getting Senator Heiner a primary challenger, so he may be able to. I'm just kidding. In actuality, I understand the concerns, but I think voter turnout remains a challenge, whether it be primary or general election, and I think both parties would like to see more of their registered members show up whenever there's a ballot. And I think there's a real opportunity here to gain more interest in the June primary should a constitutional amendment make its way onto the ballot, and it certainly could increase primary turnout. We certainly would like an engaged public. I believe that there'll be significant attempts to move Marcy's Law by the proponents, and so I think there'll be plenty of exposure to the fact that there's going to be a potential constitutional amendment in June. I understand it's out of the ordinary. We're not breaking new ground here. But should the Senate decide and the House concur that that's the best place for it, I think that's the direction we'll head. And, you know, it could actually be something that stimulates voter interest not only in June but all the way through the rest of the year into November. So I think the ramifications remain to be seen, and we'll have to see what the will of the legislature is here, and then the governor, of course, because we could pass whatever we want. He might veto it. If he does, we'll have to consider an override at some point. So we'll have to wait and see.
One of the other things I've seen is some potential savings by putting it on the June primary ballot, and that was, like, for Pennington County alone, I think they could realize upwards to a $400,000 savings by doing that, by moving it up just those few months. And who knows, maybe in following up with Senator Curd, is if we go down this road, it might spark more interest for people to show up for a primary election. Throw more constitutional amendments on the June primary ballot.
Bad idea.
You heard it here.
There are a pair of bills, Senate Bill 214 and House Bill 1311, that deal with increasing legislator pay. Do you have any opinion on that issue? And it would go into effect as written in 2019. Any concerns about finding the additional revenue this year to make that a reality for 2019?
For me, I don't know that we've really taken a caucus position on it, but for me, right now I'm opposing measures like that. Looking at the numbers that we have for our budget and the priorities that we need to be looking at, I think that there are higher priorities than legislator pay for me at this time. And that's the position I'm going to take. There's no doubt at some point there probably needs to be a deeper conversation about legislator pay, but I personally don't believe that pay is the reason that you serve. It certainly could play a factor, but I mean, the reality is you could double the pay, and I don't think it's going to necessarily increase the diversity of people that are running for the legislature. I think it's more of a conversation about the private sector being willing and encouraging their employees to run for office and to allow them to serve, knowing that they may be gone for a couple months and may have some responsibilities outside of the legislative session. as well. And so I think it's a broader conversation about encouraging public service as it relates to the private sector. Because what you have out here right now, and I'm a perfect example of that, is that if my employer didn't allow me to come serve, I wouldn't be here whether I was making $6,000 a year or $12,000 a year. It wouldn't matter. $12,000 a year wouldn't be enough. And so my employer allows me to serve, and they view it as important, and public service as important. And I think that's the conversation we should be having and encouraging.
I'll take a stab at that. So since I first was elected almost 10 years ago, this discussion occurs every year. And I believe that the last time legislator pay was adjusted was 20 years ago or thereabouts. I think it's probably time that the legislature have the courage to act on the issue. I think Senator Sutton is correct in some regard in that we would like to see employers enable and foster legislative service across a broader spectrum of South Dakota. But I do think it remains a concern as the political world has become more complex and our state legislature and the role that state government serves for the citizens has become more complex and broader. It's certainly not a 2.5 month position. Legislative service lasts from the time you start to campaign through the election, the session, and then throughout the rest of the year. Many of our members serve on committees that serve throughout the summer and the fall. Some meet monthly, and there isn't a day go by that I don't get approached by someone in Sioux Falls asking me about some kind of legislative event or interact with the Legislative Research Council or talk to Senator Maher about what we're planning on doing. So it really is a full-time position. It requires a lot of time and energy. We would still be, if legislative pay was increased to the level that's proposed, one of the lowest compensated, least serviced legislatures in the country. We don't have staff except shared staff. We don't have private offices, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that the South Dakota taxpayer gets a good value for the amount, excuse me, that they remunerate us. And I think it's probably appropriate that the legislature have the political courage and will to address the issue. I think it will broaden the number of folks considering serving. Being potentially out of personal income for 3 months, 25% of the year, is an extraordinary burden to ask someone to bear who's full-time employed when you consider that Tax Freedom Day for most of us doesn't occur until May. So if you cut the first 3 months out of that, you're going to be working until August or September just to cover your federal tax burden for many, many South Dakota people. And I think that's an extraordinary lift for the average South Dakotan to bear. A modest pay raise, I think, would help alleviate some of that. It's certainly not going to stimulate someone who would otherwise not be engaged in serving. But I personally think it's probably time for us to stop pushing it on to some future legislature and deal with it. There is no other mechanism for addressing legislative pay other than for the legislature to address it itself. And so for me personally, I welcome the opportunity to weigh in on it. And I'm going to listen, like I always do, to the pros and cons and then make a decision. But at this point, I would tell you in general, I'm supportive of the concept. It doesn't apply to us retroactively. It's for only folks that are elected in the future. And quite honestly, we don't know what that ballot looks like yet. Many of our members haven't turned in their petitions yet. We hope that most do, as we've got some really talented legislators out there. But it could be a whole crop of new folks. So I'm looking forward to the opportunity to weigh in.
Just following up along those lines, here in 2020, we're going to redistrict again, or 2021, and as the metropolitan areas continue to grow and the rural areas decline in population, you're going to see legislative districts continue to grow and grow and grow. And when you're not here in Pierre particularly, you're still traveling those legislative districts. And as someone who has the largest district in the state of South Dakota already, I can only anticipate that district probably growing by a few thousand more square miles. And that expense is bared by whoever is serving in that capacity. You're talking about, my legislative district alone is over 17,000 square miles. And all those people would like you to eventually show up at their doorstep or at their community event at some point during your career. And those expenses are borne by the person holding that office. And so if we can somehow encourage people to run by enticing them through a pay scale or of some sort, I would probably be more unfavorable of looking at that, you know, along those lines of what's coming before us here in State Affairs in the next week or so.
And I would agree with those sentiments. When I call candidates, you know, to try to recruit them to run for office, you know, a lot of them say, I can't afford it. And, you know, and that takes somebody who I think would do a good job representing their district, and it just takes them out. What I've heard in my Cracker Barrels is, you know, they're okay with a modest raise. You know, obviously they don't want us to come to Pierre and get rich. And I don't think anybody comes to Pierre with that mentality. But I think it's probably time we have the discussion.
You see, we are in 75% agreement.
Seems like I'm in the minority again.
That's just because you're leaving.
Two of the petition bills that State Affairs passed out yesterday, the circulating bills from Representatives Dennert and Mickelson. I think, Senator Curd, you seemed a little bit on the fence, but voted for Mickelson's bill. If you've given any thought to how those would impact attracting petition circulators and whether they could actually have the effect of, you know, getting paid people in there and dissuading volunteers if you have 300 volunteers and you have to print out a sheet for each one of them, for example, with their name and address and phone number.
Sure. Well, as you heard me say yesterday, it's not that dramatic a change for me. We still have to sign an attestation at the bottom of a petition that you're the person who circulated it. It has to be notarized. So unless someone is trying to willfully commit fraud, I don't see that it is that big of an additional burden. It's certainly a change, but I think it's pretty clear that we would prefer that people from South Dakota circulate petitions as required by law, and that if we can make the attempt to certify that more stringent, I think it's something that we should certainly consider. I think in general the Senate will probably find favor with that, but it is a change. It's an additional burden for a circulator, but not that big a burden. With the technology we have available now and the assurance from the Secretary of State's office that those things can be accomplished readily and without any significant delay, I don't think it's too much to ask. Certainly when I get approached at the courthouse in Sioux Falls, I wonder, you know, who is this person circulating? There's been all kinds of options that have been postulated. Some people have said, in fact, my law enforcement friends have said when they go out and try and enforce the law, it's difficult for them because they can't tell who the person is or where they're from. They'll say they don't have their ID on them, et cetera. And some of my police officer friends have suggested that we actually register petition circulators and make them pay a fee and then wear a badge that says that who they are and where they're from. It would make their job in law enforcement easier. Otherwise, they're kind of stuck and they're not as familiar with the law as they might like to be. So they sometimes, excuse me, get into a debate with the circulator about what's correct and what isn't. So I think the steps we can take to ensure that there's South Dakota folks circulating petitions that are of interest to South Dakota residents is important. And I think we should do everything we can to encourage that the folks that are out there on the streets talking to citizens are from our state.
Well, I heard those bills as well. To me, I think the one bill was almost written out of spite. What I think we should be doing is doing a better job in the legislature. I think if we were doing a better job here, we wouldn't see as many bills or as many measures put straight to the ballot. And part of that is a good, strong two-party system. I think we would get better legislation through the session, and we probably wouldn't have to deal with this as much. But now, you know, the voters have realized, hey, we can bypass the legislature, just go straight to the ballot.
And I guess I would say, as far as those specific bills, I think some of the requirements written, and I know that there were 10 bullet points in the one bill. The two or three of them were struck out of there in committee. I still have some issue with some of the remaining bullet points, including having to do with where you're kids are going to college, I think was one of them, or what, you know, if they're going to a South Dakota university, I think was one of the bullet points. I don't know why some of those things are really necessary to determine whether you're a South Dakota resident or not, and I think that some of it just becomes kind of onerous, I think, and I think it will serve to have a bit of a chilling effect on volunteers as it relates to circulating petitions. So I clearly opposed it in committee, and I'm going to oppose it on the floor again today.
If I could ask about SB 187, this is the wine licensing that passed out of the Senate, and it goes before the House Local Government Committee today. Developing here is that the grape growers are going to appear in opposition of this and testify that, among other things, passage of the bill could put them out of business as grape growers. I'm just wondering if that new testimony changes any thoughts on the Senate side, or how that bill is going. Anything new there?
Well, we're at a little bit of a disadvantage not being able to hear what the new information is, if it is new. It could be same information presented in a different way, never know for sure. But I think, you know, the debate we heard about it was fairly compelling. As we all know, I believe South Dakota does not have optimum climate for grape growing, and the regions that we can grow it is limited. And so there are businesses in our state that would like to continue to produce, blend, and make wine. I'm sure they would like to do that with South Dakota grapes to the best of their ability to do so. But when there's a dearth of resources, you have to look for other options. I know that there has been a significant amount of discussion amongst the parties to get the bill to where it was when it passed the Senate. If the House State Affairs Committee, is that where you said it was, or Commerce? Commerce?
House Judiciary.
187's in House Judiciary? Well, wherever it is, if that committee amends it,
House Local Government.
So if that committee makes changes to it and changes perhaps the percentage of grapes from outside or fluid, you know, the grape juice, if it changes the percentage, we'll have to address it and either concur with it or send it to a conference committee to hash it out. So without knowing what they're going to do with it at this point, it's difficult to give you a great answer, but in general, I'm supportive of it the way it came out of the Senate.
Yeah, and I think I would agree with those sentiments as well. We didn't hear much for concerns as it relates to the question you posed, but that doesn't mean that those concerns won't come up as the bill changes. It's amazing how a small change to a bill can change the complete complexity and outcome as well, and so we'll have to see what that looks like when it comes back for our concurrence if they amend it on the House side.
Along those lines, when I sat in on the committee hearing on this, and it was in Senate Local Government, a lot of the confusion was around the labeling laws, and those are all federally dictated about what can be on that label. And I think that as someone who's really novice, bottled and produced means one thing, and then made and bottled is another thing, and blended and bottled is one thing, and cellared and bottled is another thing. And so it's all those federal labeling laws that the general person doesn't understand. And it's, I think if that's where the thing is. And so I think they're going to work with, at one time when the conversation was, work with the Department of Agriculture to come up with what a certified South Dakota wine is, that it must be grown and bottled in South Dakota. And I think that's where the big bone of contention is going to lie, is because the Department of Ag hasn't done that yet. And so the South Dakota wine, the local wineries that are using South Dakota grapes, doing everything in South Dakota, really need to sit down with the Department of Agriculture and separate themselves and come up with their own labeling and the own requirements. And that all has to be done through it's something we can't legislate. It's something that has to be done through the Department of Ag. So that's where they're a lot of the angst and stuff is coming about from.
I know the House is standing out there, but I guess real quick, the bill that would move texting while driving and looking at text messages from a secondary to a primary offense that failed in Senate Judiciary, have you guys heard from those in the committee as to why that bill failed?
I have not heard from them why it failed. I would guess that it didn't meet the merits of passing it based on the testimony they heard in committee, but I have not approached them to articulate the reason why, nor have they offered the rationale behind defeating it. In the past, it has gone something along the line of we have statute already for distracted driving and so on, or careless and imprudent driving, other terms for it. So maybe they felt it was covered in that regard already, and a separate offense was not necessary. Despite that, I think it is clear that utilizing an electronic device at high speed or even at low speed is potentially problematic, and I think we've all seen videos about that, or crash statistics and so on. What I asked the insurance industry to provide and have not had a chance to see it is states that showed a decrease in injury or fatality rates after passing texting as a primary offense, to see if there's any kind of empirical data out there about the results. We made a major change to our traffic laws here a couple years ago with the 80-mile-an-hour speed limit on the interstate, and that has had not that significant, if any, effect on the fatality rate on South Dakota interstates. So despite some of the protestations that it might have that impact, so we haven't seen that materialize yet, thank goodness. But I'd be interested in the data, and then I'm sure that bill will resurface again in some future legislature.
I haven't heard anything either from our caucus. We didn't really discuss that yet as to why it failed, but I would agree with a lot of the sentiments there that what we do up here does need to be based on data, and I'm assuming they had that discussion in committee, but I don't know why or why not it failed. So, but I think we're about out of time here. I just wanted to thank my friends on the other side of the aisle here, Senator Kurd, Senator Maher, for suggesting this idea. And I thought it was a very good idea. I think it's always good that we remember that I think we have more in common than not up here. We've talked about it before, that if you probably went and looked at statistically how we have voted over all the bills that we've had, I bet you would find it's a very high percentage that we vote the same way. And I think it's always important to remember that there are obviously certain issues that seek to divide us, but at the end of the day, I think it's important to remain civil, and even though we disagree, we don't have to be disagreeable, and that we can work together on a lot of issues, and we should always be striving to work together as best we can and leave still being friends.
I think Senator Sutton's right. Billy and I were talking about that yesterday on the Senate floor, that we believe that we have a high correlative voting rate. We believe that we're in agreement the vast majority of the time. We certainly have some philosophical differences, but they're pretty narrow, and I think that's reflective of the people that are here in South Dakota. There are some issues that we have differences of opinion on, and I think we agreed not to go do an analysis of it because we don't want to be disappointed to find out that we don't agree as much as we think we do. It's been a real pleasure serving with Billy. He's going to leave the Senate, and he's certainly looking at other things. I don't know if I'll be back yet or not. But I'll certainly miss him in the legislative process because he's been a real joy to work with, and certainly one of the things that I look forward to the most coming to Pierre. Thank you.
Down to the last week of session. It has gone so fast. Incredible amount of bills that we have gone through, I think, in a very orderly fashion. It's worked very well. Everybody's worked their tail off to get to this point. I guess the highlight for me of this past week was getting 1081 out of the Senate yesterday on the non-meandered waters. That's a fight that's been going on for 20 years, and I think we've got a resolution that's working very well, and without that sunset on there, I believe it's going to work even better, because I know there's people that were looking for some long-term stuff as far as opening their lakes up, and I will virtually guarantee that their lakes will be opened without that sunset on that might not have been, just because of that fact. So look forward to your questions.
Well, good morning. Spence Hawley, minority leader for the House, District 7. This is kind of an interesting press conference, as you all know. We're as a combined conferences, and see how it goes. We are looking forward to the discussions that we get into. I'm sure it'll probably be the same discussions we have on the floor get in. But I would probably echo Representative Qualm's comments that despite the massive number of bills we had this year, that I think I was surprised where we're at right now on our workload and how many few bills we've got left to work with. So the big issue coming up now, as you know, is the budget discussions, and that will put the framework to the whole session on it. The 1081, I would also echo that I thought that was good that we got that out after being involved with the summer task force, and the last two bills that we've brought up in past years, it's kind of nice to get this resolutions done, and then as we go down the years, we can tweak this thing to make it better. A couple issues that we've got coming that I see a discussion from our standpoint was the 1174, the Marcy's Law that passed the changes to it. Modifications, which was good that it passed in the Senate. The bad news is they put on the amendment in the Senate to bring it in the primary, and as we've stated several times, that's just something we can't support to do that. The other one is the Building South Dakota, SB 81. That the governor's bill on changing Building South Dakota, and on the Senate side, they're stripping out the Workforce Development Fund. And they're stripping out the Economic Development Partnership Fund. And the Economic Development Partnership Fund we don't have so much problem with, but we do with the workforce development and CTEs that the schools are using and all that with it. So that'll be a big discussion for us next week as we get going. Other than that, I'll let Julie has some comments, and Kent, before we open it up.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, and it's a pleasure to be here. Julie Bartling, Assistant Democratic Leader. I echo what the two leaders have said. You know, we've had a good session, and we're down to the end where the budget's probably the main focus now. I do know that we do have a couple bills that'll be before us on the floor concerning the AG's measures on meth and opioids, and I know that'll be a good discussion. Certainly issues that we need to discuss. They're not only prevalent, you know, in South Dakota, but across the United States. So I think it's something we need to take a very good look at and address, not only what the AG needs to do, but going forward, what we as a legislature needs to do to help combat that epidemic and resolve that here in South Dakota. Thank you.
Good morning. Representative Kent Peterson, Assistant Majority Leader from Salem. Just kind of an echoing of all the comments we've had. You know, it's been interesting, as Representative Hawley was talking about, you know, where we were looking, staring down the gauntlet of the bill load that we had. And you know, a couple days ago I looked, and there were only 30, I think we had 30 bills on the floor, we took 24 of them. We had 30 bills in committee, so all of a sudden we were kind of down to, we're in pretty good shape. And in my opinion, that's gonna leave more time to discuss the budget and as we start to figure out the priorities and the order of our priorities. You know, that'll be a lot of, we've already started having those discussions within our caucus, and we're going to continue those over the weekend, and so that way we can get back, you know, get right to it Monday and wrap up the bill load. Obviously, we're going to have some bills that probably we have to go into conference committee on, and something that we've been working on a lot is the Precision Ag project, and you know, we're really starting to get closer to some resolution possibly on the financing side of that, and that'll be getting rolled out here, and so that'll be I think a pretty large discussion next week, as well as we're trying to figure out how to finalize getting that project completed. So again, look forward to your questions.
Well, yeah, can you all talk about Marcy's Law, when the House might take up that concurrence, and then do you know anything about the secondary bill that's going to be required to adjust some of the time frames?
I'm not sure the number of the bill, but I know the Senate passed to have it in, go through the primary in June, and a part of the reason for that is we want to get that law off as quickly as possible so that the other stuff that we've put in place can start working. I understand where the minority leader is coming from, you know, as far, you know, we don't want to set a precedence doing this, but I think in this instance, I think that there's merit for moving this forward and getting it taken care of as quickly as possible.
You know, all I know on that second bill is what was brought up on the floor. And we hadn't really talked about a primary vote over on this side, but evidently for the funding to do the election process, they need some extra funds to do it, is what I gathered, and I haven't heard what bill they're using for that yet, and unless you're all familiar with it. So I'm looking forward to see what that discussion, I assume, well, they're going to have that in the next couple days, too, so we can find out what it is.
When the speaker discussed moving the potentially moving it to the June primary, I think his exact words were it would require broad bipartisan support. It clearly doesn't have that, so why move forward then?
I guess with just the reasons I stated before is I think it's something that needs to be taken care of as quickly as possible. The people that originally brought the Marcy's Law are willing to help fund to get rid of it because they were very instrumental in putting this stuff together. Matter of fact, at the end, they kind of apologized and wished they had gone this route before and talked to the legislators and tried to do something instead of trying to ram something down our throat. They're finding the same thing in other states where they're trying to do this, that, you know, maybe that's not the way to do it. Maybe they should have discussions with people that know the state and how it should be run. So, obviously, the funding, you know, to get it done, it's not going to be an easy task to get it done. And I have not seen the bill either. I don't know a lot of the details. You know, those will be forthcoming, obviously, this next week. We'll have to see it pretty quickly to see what's going on. But, I'm not exactly sure the details either.
We haven't had those discussions yet within our caucus anyway. And so, you know, I can't really speak for our members at this point to see if that be something that they're going to support or not. You know, obviously, it was briefly mentioned in the State Affairs Committee meeting, I think, when we were talking about this bill originally on the House side, but that was about it. And so, you know, it's kind of, we'll see. I mean, I'm not sure, you know, how our members are going to approach that.
If I might, when it was back on our side of the House, we did allow the Marcy's Law people to come in and visit with our members. And they did want the primary vote, and we talked to them and listened to it, and you know, I'm disappointed that it's ended up going down this route, because the process that was used at that time to solve the Marcy Law initiated measure problems and the work back and forth was really excellent. I just kind of, and I think our group does, comes down at the end doesn't justify the means. We still need to keep the process, and you need to honor the process. And at what point do we say, well, this is the most important thing, that we change the process? I think in my 8 years up here, I could give you a dozen bills where we should change the process that I thought. But ultimately, you got to honor the process.
Well, and I just worry that putting this
this measure on a primary ballot, oftentimes there are a number of voters who just, who will not, don't, if they don't have a primary to vote in, for example, in their legislative district or countywide elections or something of that nature, they may just not go to the vote. So I don't know that the amendment will get, in my opinion, a fair shot at what the voters can see the good of this amendment. I think it just will get a better shot in the fall election.
There are a pair of bills, Senate Bill 214 and House Bill 1311, that deal with raising legislator pay, and that would go into effect beginning next year as it's written now. Do you have any thoughts about allocating that funding this year and getting it done in the next week, and where that money might come from?
Those discussions are happening. You know, we know what the exact cost is going to be if this would pass. So that is potentially a line item in the budget. You know, if the bills, you know, make it all the way through, obviously signed by the governor, then we need to know what that cost is, and we are aware of that, and that's something the appropriators are looking at this time. And, you know, it's going to be one of those that obviously will probably come down to when the bill ultimately passes or fails. So.
You know, I don't know what the Senate's going to do on it, and we've had the bill a couple times in the House, and just I think there is support, and everybody realizes that we do need to raise the wages for legislators. And from the budget standpoint, we've had the opportunity to visit with the probe side on a overall game plan, where they see the funds going this year, and that was addressed, and it is one of the options. Obviously, not all those are going to end up in it. If I just might make a quick comment when you're talking the budget, we do line really close with our goals that are being talked right now, at least on the House side. I don't know how you guys are doing with your Senate compatriots over there, but we're supportive of what their the increases are projected for state employees, for K-12, for the CSPs out there, community support providers. Those things that we have been what we consider really important, and that is in a discussion very much so. And so we felt with majority of the discussion is going that way, I don't see a big fight from our side on where we're headed with the budget discussions. Obviously, there's not a lot of dollars to deal with, but try to get out as much as possible.
Obviously, there was some incidents that occurred last week, and I was wondering if I could, if maybe leadership could possibly speak to the decision by Kaiser and May to bring the committee to investigate what happened between Representatives Johnson and DeSanto, and why it wasn't, I guess, the leadership of the party.
I'm not sure if I heard the last part of that question.
There was a press conference held by Representatives DeSanto and May, and they were concerned about whether or not this would get this incident would get addressed, and I didn't know the majority leadership could speak to that.
Well, we started addressing this. I was part of the confrontation. I was there, and I saw something going on, and I just went down to the front and just said, hey, break it up. This is, you know, don't need to do any more than that. Right away, we started talking to DeSanto, the Representative DeSanto. The next morning, we had meetings with Representative DeSanto. We also had meetings with Representative Johnson. And so a lot of that next day, we talked with them. You told them what their options were and told Representative Sand, it's up to you what you do with this. I mean, we're not going to file anything. It's up to you. You have to make that decision. You're the one if you feel like you need to do something. And so Representative Kaiser and Representative May decided to do that the next day. And so within a very short amount of time, things are happened. We had a
committee appointed, and we move forward with that. When we appointed that committee, we felt very good about the committee we appointed. It was people that were not friends of either one. It was a lot of females on there. It was Democrats. It was Republicans. And we had a judge as the head of the committee. And I felt very comfortable with who we had on there, that there would have been a very fair hearing if it would have taken forth.
We got a little bit of maybe context about what happened from Representatives May and DeSanto, and I was curious if you heard the words that Representative Johnson was alleged to have used. Was it to that volume, and did you hear them?
I never heard anything he said. I was visiting with a legislator about halfway back, and I never heard anything that he said, not one word. And I just went up there. I could see it was a discussion. I thought it had probably gone on long enough and didn't need to go anymore, so I just stepped in. But the words that were in the press conference, I know other people that were there, that's not what they heard.
Representative DeSanto said she was told by Representative Mickelson that continuing the discussion on this would give the Republican caucus a black eye. Did you hear about that? Do you have any comment on that?
I never heard those exact words said. I was not in on all the meetings, but I was in on a lot of them. Obviously, a situation like this, you know, if it can be worked out within the caucus, that's what we want to do. You know, if we can come to an agreement. And but we never once said not to move forward with the process if that's what they wanted to do.
We have a very defined process for in our rules for handling things like this. The process was engaged and then ultimately disengaged by the people that brought it. Pretty straightforward, honestly, and that's why we have that process within our rules.
From both sides, do you have anything that you learn from this experience, anything you take away should something similar occur in the future?
Well, like I just said, I think, you know, we have the process in our rules for a reason. If something rises to that level and members feel that there is an issue, there is a clear path to bringing about something like this. And, you know, that's why we have that in our rules.
I think it's very important for us as legislators to also convey to our constituency and to everyone across the state that it's important that when these type of issues arise within our own house, per se, that we need to take care of it. We need to address it. We need to let the public know that this is not something that we condone. We do not stand for that. We need to lead by example. And so when situations like this do arise, as Representative Peterson said, we have the protocol to take care of it, and we need to follow through with that and not give the perception or indication that it's something we don't want to take care of, that it must be taken care of. And I hope that, you know, as this situation continues to cool down, hopefully, that our public will know that we do address things. We do not let them get out. We hope that they don't get out of hand.
You know, I would say from our standpoint as on leadership, the decorum of the body is there for a reason and is to prevent these. The formalized process that we go through and not addressing people by name on the floor, everything is designed to keep the debate. You know, they get heated anyhow, but keep them from crossing the line during the debates, and we emphasize that quite a bit. I think that as leadership, that's where we help to prevent a lot of this discussion, is we make sure those lines aren't crossed, and just keep explaining with the legislatures the purpose for the rules the way they are. And if it does happen, then we just need to address it head on, and come up with the best resolution as possible, as soon as possible on it, but no matter which way it goes.
Anytime you have 70 people together, it's pretty easy for somebody to get married to a bill. We say, don't get married to your bill, but hey, I've done it before, everybody's done it before, and sometimes you can feel very offended, and you know, when it's all said and done, and if things can get out of hand, but that's why we have rules in place. And we talk about, you know, you can attack the bill, but don't attack the person. Well, sometimes you slip a little bit beyond that, and sometimes it happens, and it's unfortunate when it does. But that's why we have rules in place, so that we can address it if somebody feels somebody went too far, and then we investigate it, we find out, and if steps are appropriate to take, we take those steps.
Do we need to see a day where the sergeant-at-arms and the LRC protective staff are on the floor at all times that members are on the floor?
Do you want to address that?
Okay, run that by. I'm not sure I understand.
Do we need to have LRC sergeant-at-arms and the protective staff who enforce the rules, should they be on the floor all the time that members are on the floor enforcing the rules all the time, not just while you're in session, but all the time the members are on the floor, because no one else can enforce those rules?
Well, I believe that the sergeant-at-arms is on the floor at all times now when there's somebody around. Typically, I think that we, you know, any time I've ever usually walked in there, they're there. I guess I don't know exactly what their schedule is and when they're there. Obviously when incidents happen, it's always time to review your protocols and your rules, and if something is necessary to be changed, then that's obviously a good time to look at it. But as we've stated, we always talk about decorum and trying to set the example for, you know, as I come to the Capitol each day, I know there are people here that are probably here for maybe the first and only time in their life. And how we act that day is going to be remembered by them for the rest of their life. And I think it's important that we have that in the back of our mind all the time. And when we're thinking about doing something or saying something, you know, we need to think about, you know, what's the effect? So I don't know if having more people on the floor, a sergeant at arms, et cetera, would make a difference or not.
You know, we have and this gets into the security discussion, and we've addressed that at the executive board for the last couple of years. We've had discussions on this with the sergeant of arms involvement also on security. The Capitol security provided plainclothes security that's on the floor and up in the balcony, and that has been increased over our discussions over the last few years. So, and then it is covered by video, as you all saw. All the areas. So I think that those areas have been addressed from a security standpoint already. From what I saw, and it was more of a replay on TV that I saw, is it was a pretty short, brief moment, and it's real hard for anybody, unless you're standing right there, to come down and get in the middle of it immediately. But I think that the security process that we've discussed and gone through, I feel comfortable with it in the Capitol.
On a different topic, do you all know how the governor's craft brewing compromise might go through the House? Is there, it passed unanimously out of the Senate, is there agreement to continue kind of that trend, or any concerns?
We haven't had that discussion yet, so I guess I haven't looked that closely at the bill yet, but I believe that those two, one bill are going to be in the Commerce Committee next week, I believe. Yeah. So I'm sure they'll have a very thorough discussion there, and should it make it out of the committee, we will have that discussion on the floor on Tuesday, I'd imagine. So
I know there's been a lot of compromise back and forth to get to this point. I have not looked at the bill either. I know there's some people that were very much against it that are for it now. So I know things have changed a lot. So look forward to the debate they have in committee, and we'll see what happens if it gets to the floor.
You know, that was a Commerce Committee that we had that, and we had it briefly up front. We had some basic discussions on it, and there was some real divisiveness on it. And I think that what they've come to with the agreement now, the 30,000 barrel limitation is pretty much come an agreement to. There was discussion of going back to 15,000, but everybody came on to that. The other part was the local breweries being able to market directly was the big issue for a lot of the small breweries, and they put a I believe it's a 1,500 barrel limitation on it. And I think that it's a good compromise. And from both parties that were talking to us before that were upset, the ones that I talk to now, both sides feel real good with the compromise. So I don't see a major problem coming through the committee, and then I would expect that it shouldn't have a problem on the floor.
Do you know when the Marcy's Law concurrence might be voted on? Not today, next week, or?
Not today for sure, but I guess I would imagine that would probably be Monday or Tuesday.
Week. I anticipate all of you have seen at least three of the gubernatorial candidates around the Capitol in the past month or so. any thoughts on the platforms that they've put forth? Do you see them acting any differently than they have in the past years that they've been around here during session?
Well, that's a difficult question.
That's an interesting question. I was not anticipating anything like that. I think it's going to be very interesting going forward. I guess I'm not going to elaborate a whole lot on it. You know, you're seeing a lot of stuff starting to happen, start to take place, a lot of information getting out, and you're going to see a lot more before it's all said and done.
I think it's fair to say there's positioning taking place.
And that's quite normal.
That's fair. Yeah, that's very fair to say that.
Yeah, I don't think it's anything different than we've seen in the past, you know. I wasn't here the last time there was an election of this, what I would call magnitude, with an open slot, you know, and so it ultimately what it's going to come down to, in my opinion, is you know, people making a decision based upon, you know, who they feel can lead South Dakota. It's that simple. So obviously they all have a different way of getting there, but it's going to come down to that, whether it be in the primary or in our general election, you know, in November. So.
Are we good? Thanks for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And cancel that ambulance. We don't need it.
Yeah. We didn't need 911.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. Programming is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional funding provided by